Hello everybody, my name is Walter, and this is episode 12 of my Redstone Component series. In this episode, I will talk about the three Redstone components that primarily deal with the transportation and manipulation of items. And those are the hopper, the dropper, and the dispenser. I will start with some general information about these blocks, then I will go in detail of how they work, and then I will give you quite a few examples of what they are usually used for. So, first things first, how can you acquire those blocks? Let's start with the hopper, which you can't find lying around usually, but you can craft it, of course. And to craft it, you need a normal chest and 5 iron ingots in this funnel or hopper shape here, which makes this, especially early in the game when you don't have an iron farm, a very expensive component, especially since you will need quite a lot of those usually for your builds. The hopper itself is also used as a crafting recipe, a source, to craft hopper minecarts, by the way. With that, let's continue with the dropper. The dropper is just a little frame of 7 cobblestone and a single redstone dust. So a very cheap resource and quite easy to be crafted in big amounts even early in the game. Then we have the dispenser. Here you can actually find 2 in each jungle temple as parts of the traps there. But if you want to craft it, you take essentially the same recipe as for the dropper and simply place a bow in the center, which also means that crafting great amounts of those is not only expensive, since you need to craft those bows, but also very annoying since the bows don't stack. So you will have to craft them one by one, which is really annoying. Next, let's talk about the blocks themselves. First the dropper and the dispenser, since they are very similar. Both are directional blocks that can be placed in the 6 primary directions, and are always placed down so that they are looking at the player. If you want to mine them, you will need a pickaxe. A wooden pickaxe is enough for that, by the way. Both are full blocks, so they can transmit redstone power. They are immovable blocks, and they don't emit or transmit light. Next up we have the hopper. This once more is a directional block, but this time it depends on the surface you are placing it against. So if you are placing it looking at this wall, you will see it running into this wall. If you are placing it against this surface, it will run into this wall here. If you are placing it against the top surface, it will go straight down. If you are placing it against the bottom surface, it will also go straight down. So there are only 5 different directions it can go. To mine it, you will once more need at least a wooden pickaxe. The hoppers themselves are transparent and immovable blocks, which is a rather interesting combination, especially since you can place redstone on top, like redstone dust or repeaters and such, which is very useful. The blocks themselves don't emit any light, but they also let light through, so they don't block a beacon, for example, or a light source. So this is also a rather interesting fact here. By the way, if you are placing them down against another block with a UI, like so, then simply use the shift key to suppress the opening of the UI of the block. And with that, let's get to the functionality. I will start with the dispenser, since it's the oldest of the 3 components. The dispenser has 9 item slots, and when it is powered, it will select one of the filled item slots at random, so there is not a predetermined order here, and will try to use whatever item is in there. If it's a normal item, it will simply expel that item as a loose item. If it is something that has a predetermined interaction, like for example an arrow or a fire charge, I will talk about what those are at a later point in this video, then it will try to use it in a specific way. For example, an arrow will be shot, similar to a fire charge. And let's see if I can. So here you can see the simple expelling of an item. There is a slight delay of 2 redstone ticks between powering and actual triggering of the dispenser. The maximum frequency of the activation of a dispenser, by the way, is 1 activation every 1 redstone tick. This requires you to actually power and depower every game tick, so this needs some specific redstone circuitry. The dispenser can be powered from all 6 sides, either directly or indirectly via full block, but it also can be powered via quasi-connectivity. So as you can see, I have this block up here, which is now powered, and the dispenser for the moment ignores that. But if I give it an update, so notice I'm not pressing the button, but simply clicking on the node block here, you can see it's activating. And you can also see it now ignores the button input, just as if it were powered directly. If I unpower it here, it will still ignore the first button press, because it was still thinking it was still powered. And that's the dispenser. Now the dropper works somewhat similar. The main difference here is that it has no interaction with those types of blocks here. It will always expel the item, for example an arrow as an item here or a fire charge, and it will not use it. Once more, it also has quasi-connectivity as a second power source. And what is different to a dispenser is that a dropper can actually be used to push an item into a container. So as you can see, the hopper here is empty. I have one item in the dropper, and when I power both, I have pushed the item into the hopper. So I can use droppers to transport items. When the dropper can push an item into a inventory, it is silent. If it is empty and powered, or if the container is full, it will actually make some noise. Now let's talk about the hopper. The hopper is a rather interesting and useful component because it can pull items and it can push items. It can pull items from the space directly on top of it, whether this is just an item lying around, or an item in an inventory slot of a container, doesn't matter here. It can also push items, but only into a container it is actually running into, so the direction of the funnel is rather important here. If the hopper is powered via redstone, directly or indirectly, it is locked, which means that it can't pull and it can't push. So for example here, this hopper is currently powered. You can see a single item in here. This hopper here is not powered, and you can see when I push the item in here or put it in there, it will directly be pushed into this hopper again. If I unlock this hopper, you will see the item going back and forth like this here. The movement of items through hoppers is determined by two timers. We have a pull timer and we have a push timer. Both start at 4 redstone ticks and count down under certain circumstances. They count down until they reach essentially 0, and when they can pull or push, or when the hopper can pull and push, they will reset. If the hopper can't pull or push, because either there is nothing to pull, there is nothing it can push into because the container is empty or not there, or for example the hopper is locked, it will then start to wait and check every game tick whether it now can be pull or push, and only then it will reset the entire thing. Furthermore, the push timer will only start to count down when there is actually something it can push. So if the item slot here is completely empty, the push counter or timer stays at the 4 redstone ticks. The pull timer, as I mentioned, will simply count down and only reset when it was able to pull something. There are two more important facts you need to know about interaction with containers. The first is that the item slots of all containers have a specific order. If you look in the Wikipedia, we'll see that they are just numbered, and usually it starts on the top left corner, then goes towards the right, then it goes into the next line, and so on and so on. So basically this here would be item slot 1, 2, 3, and so on. And the hopper will always start with the first item slot, so it will either pull or push from or to that specific item slot, depending on the situation. And if it can't do anything with that, it will look at the second item slot, then the third, and so on. So there is a predetermined order it will interact with containers. Furthermore, there are some containers that only open up certain item slots if the hopper is coming in or going from different directions or specific direction. I will talk about this in a moment. So a hopper below a container will not have access necessarily to all item slots of that container. Next up we have the observer and piston part interaction. Well, for the observer it's pretty simple. All those three components here will trigger an observer when they are being powered or depowered, as you can see here. The piston part interaction is even simpler because there is none. If you power them or depower them, it doesn't matter for a piston part, the piston part will not react. The only time it will react is if the dispenser will actually place something, but then the butt will actually react to whatever is placed and not to the dispenser itself. Next, let's talk about item flows. First, as a little side note, a comparator will give you a signal that corresponds to the actual filling level of those three components here. But let's continue on. First, let's start with a simple column of hoppers, and what you usually get here is that if you start to feed items into this line or column, you get items traveling with one block every game tick or 20 blocks a second. The reason is due to the fact that all those hoppers here are waiting to pull, meaning first game tick this one here can pull, second game tick this one here can pull, the third game tick this one here can pull. After that, all of those pull timers have been reset, and after 4 redstone ticks, we can pull the next. So while it can pull a traveling item down very fast, the overall capacity for transportation is the same as before. Now one thing you should be aware of is if you have a column of hopper setup like here, which I usually call a push-pull column, because they are all feeding into each other, you can simply break the transportation by powering just one of those hoppers. The reason is rather simple. This hopper here pushes the items in there, and this one here pulls the items. All you get is a delay of 4 redstone ticks that the item is basically waiting inside here. And this is basically the same situation as if you were to replace this hopper, for example, with a chest. If you want to make it possible to actually stop the movement, you will have to change the direction of the hopper on top of this one that you will actually want to block, so it is not able to actually push the items in there. Just one thing you should be aware of. Next up, due to a similar reason, is that if you have a setup like here, where this hopper tries to push the items in here, and this hopper here tries to pull the items and then pushing them in there, this hopper here will win. The reason is, once more, this one here with just one game tick for the thing to pull, and this one here would wait 4 redstone ticks to push. Meaning in a situation like here, it will always start to put the items from this chest into this chest, and only if this chest and this hopper is completely full, it will start to fill this chest here. A rather important thing to know when you are trying to build storage systems. Next up, again, a little column here is that a comparator actually needs an item to stay inside of a container for longer than one game tick. If we have a column of hoppers here, As mentioned before, the item only stays in here for a single game tick. Meaning, if I were to place items in this chest here, you will see the comparator completely ignores it and the items aren't even displayed inside here. Although, obviously, they are traveling through. This last hopper here, which can only push, because there is no hopper below it to pull, has the items in here for 4 game ticks, meaning it's long enough for a comparator to detect this. This is one thing you should be always aware of, that if you have a pulling hopper below here, you can't actually detect it with a comparator, except when the entire thing here starts to backlog. So if all of those containers here are full and items start to accumulate in here, then this comparator here will also turn on. So this can be some kind of overflow detection, by the way. Next up, we have some special cases of hopper interactions with containers. Dropper behave the same concerning the pushing of items. They obviously can't pull items. The first container I want to talk about is the composter, which is rather interesting because it doesn't have an actual inventory you can open, but obviously you can put stuff in there and get bone meal out. If you want to automatize this, you can push organic stuff in with a hopper from the top, and you can pull stuff out from the bottom. Then we have the 4 blocks you can see here, so the brewing stand, the smoker, the blast furnace and the normal furnace. And those have 3 different inventories. We have the raw material, we have the fuel, and we have the product. Raw material you put in from the top, fuel from the side, and the product you get from the bottom. The brewing stand is a bit special here because there is some overlap. The raw material is in here. The blaze powder and the bottles you put in come from the side, so they are the fuel essentially, and the product you also pull from here, so there is a bit overlap of fuel and product. Next up, the hopper also interacts with chest minecarts and hopper minecarts. So even though those two are entities and not blocks, they are interacting with those here. Obviously, you can pull stuff from the bottom and push from the top and the sides. The shulker box works like a normal container, but one special case is if you try to push a shulker box into another shulker box. That will obviously not work and makes some kind of special item sorters possible. And finally, we have the ender chest. Although this is a container, the hopper and the dropper won't interact with it because obviously they wouldn't know for which player they have to do that. Following that, let's talk about dispenser interactions. As mentioned in the very beginning, the dispenser has quite a few of different items it will actually use instead of simply dispensing it. I tried to group them a bit and I came up with those groups you can see here. The biggest group are those that basically summon entity or place a block. The first are all kind of mob spawn eggs. Obviously you only get them in the creative menu. Armor stands will be placed in front of the dispenser. TNT will be dispensed as primed TNT, so you have about 4 seconds until it explodes. Then all types of minecarts are dispensed if there is a rail in front of the dispenser. If there is no rail in front of the dispenser, they will be dispensed as items. Boats will also be dispensed as an actual boat entity. Then carved pumpkins and player or mob heads will be simply placed down, the same as true for shulker boxes. The carved pumpkin, when it completes a golem structure, will actually summon a golem, so you can somewhat automatize this process. Then we have various types of projectiles, the arrows in all different types. Then you have the splash potion and the lingering potions, snowballs and eggs, fireworks and, as seen before, fire charges, and also bottles of enchanting, although you usually don't get them in the survival. Then we have things that get equipped to the player, to armor stands or humanoid mobs, which are all types of armor, then elytra, the shield, carved pumpkins, player or mob heads, and this obviously only happens if the corresponding item slot or inventory slot is free. If not, they will be simply dispensed as an item. Little side note here, mobs can only have either a shield or a weapon, not both. Then we have player-like interactions. So those are used just as if a player was using them in that situation. Just activated on the place directly in front of the dispenser. Bone meal will lead to growth of trees or whatever. Shears will shear sheep. Flint and steel will either produce fire if there is an air block in front of the dispenser, or it will prime TNT. If there is water or lava in front of the dispenser, it will be sucked into a bucket and then you will get a water or a lava bucket. And you can go also the opposite direction by placing down a source block. You can also empty a bucket of fish. Or you can fill glass bottles if there is a water source in front of the dispenser. And the last I want to mention is the trident. The trident is currently not one of those special cases here, except within the Java Edition Comet test version of the game. So there is a good chance that the trident will be added as a projectile to the dispenser in the near future. And of course there is a good chance that they will add further interactions or further special cases to the dispenser in the future updates, because they did it in any of the big updates in the past. Now before I get to the examples, just a few words concerning the lag generation and possible fixes for those when it comes to those three components here. The first is the dispenser. With the dispenser you can create a large amount of entities in a very small amount of time. Especially if you run it on a fast clock and many many of them in parallel. The only way around it is avoiding that situation, but there is no real workaround there. The next, which can produce a surprising amount of lag, is if you have droppers that are actually backlogging. So if those droppers here, as you can see, they are all full, the container here is full, and if you try to pour all of them, they create a surprising amount of lag, at least to my experience. A simple workaround here is having some kind of overflow protection, either by stopping the inflow when the entire thing is backlogging, or by having an overflow line, which for example just runs them into an item destroyer. And the last, rather known one, has to do with hoppers. As mentioned before, the hoppers check every game tick whether the space above them has anything to pull in. Those checks get reduced when you put droppers on top of them. For some time it was furnaces, but with some of the latest changes that changed to droppers. I will put a link in the description for a video by Xizuma where he explained it a bit more in detail. And with that we finally get to the examples. I will start with those primarily for the dispenser. First of all is the quick armor station. And here basically you just run in between those two sides here and press the button and are completely kitted out. Can be even combined with a respawn detection system, so when you respawn next to your bed, you are automatically re-kitted to get back to where you were killed. Another rather common use is the dispenser's bone meal, used in many kinds of tree farms or micro farms for wheat and other field fruits. Then we have automatic minecart stations. So here, all you have to do is stand on this pressure plate and the minecart gets dispensed. And if you click on the minecart, you get in there and it automatically gets sent off. And if it comes from the opposite side, it is automatically destroyed and reinserted into the system. This is, by the way, also an example for hoppers and a little hidden dropper down there. And a rather obvious use for dispensers is as part of traps. All you need is a dispenser and a fast clock and a couple arrows, and you have your simple trap. This can be even done through a wall, because if the wall is currently moving, it doesn't obstruct the actual shooting. Something rather interesting there. And with that, let's get to the hopper and the dropper. First of all, the hopper can also be used as a building block. So, as mentioned before, it's a transparent block that is immovable and allows you to put redstone, for example, redstone dust on top. So it can be used as a non-movable alternative, for example, to slabs, which is very useful if you need to transport signals up in this kind of way, but have slime blocks or honey blocks moving in the vicinity. And the next few examples are very obvious. So, of course, you can use a hopper to collect items, either from an item stream like a water stream, or even from the top of a non-full block, like, for example, a soul sand block, or a honey block, or a half step, or similar. Once you have collected them, you may want to transport them somewhere, and you can do this with a hopper chain. Then once more you have downwards movement, one game tick per block, and sideways, four redstone ticks per block, or eight game ticks. If you use droppers, you can actually adjust the speed sideways. So here we have items in there, and those here are all empty, and here I'm transporting it with one game tick per block, for example. So this can be easily adjusted. If you want to transport them upwards, you can also use droppers in a dropper elevator like this here, which is nowadays somewhat old school, but works nevertheless. And it is also completely silent if you build it the right way. Another cheaper version is using just a single dropper with a clock here, and on top of that a little cross section of completely full blocks, so there are no air gaps in here. And then you can see the items are dropped and then travel up through those blocks here. At the top you usually want to have a water stream to collect the items and then pull them or push them back into a hopper. The reason you can put a hopper up here nowadays is, since I believe it was with 1.13, the hoppers actually became a non-full block, which means that now the items will actually start to accumulate below the hoppers and will not travel through the hoppers on top where they would be collected. Then we have storage systems. They can be built vertically or horizontally. You can also sort items that uses the locking functionality of a hopper, and also the fact that hoppers will only or will start to try to pull from the leftmost item slot. Another thing you can do is actually combine item sorting and storage. A link for one video where this is explained a bit more in detail you will find in the description, but basically I have two chests here. One chest has stackable items in here, and each slot has at least one item in there. And then I have an overflow chest where everything that can be sorted into this chest actually goes. And then I have a chest here, four of those items here can actually be sorted, the rest can't be sorted. And as you can see, the items are pulled, land in the respective item slot, and if they can't be selected or sorted out, they land in this chest down here. This can be built tileable to create very compact and easily adjustable sorting systems and storage systems. Another rather interesting use for those components are Redstone circuits like monostables and randomizers. So here we have a simple dropper and a hopper running into each other, and if I power them, I get just a short pulse out of this comparator here. The same here. But what I also get is, if I put a stackable and a non-stackable item in there, a randomizer. Now I have a signal strength 1, now 3, then 1, then 1, and so on. So I get a completely randomized output here. You can also build memory circuits, so T flip-flops and RS knowledges. And the interesting part here is that both are completely built out of immovable blocks. Can also build quite a few different types of clocks. So a simple ring of hoppers creates a hopper ring clock. Each hopper adds 4 redstone ticks of delay, and obviously there is always an even number of hoppers here. We can even have more than one output here to have a synchronized sequence going on. Then this here is the quite famous EFO or Ifonian clock, which simply has a cycle time that is adjusted through the number of items inside of those hoppers here. And well, basically this has 2 semi-stable states and flips between those 2. Then next we have this very old school 5-minute despawn timer, which basically just waits until this item here despawns after 5 minutes before putting in the next item, and then waiting once more 5 minutes, and then the next item, and so on and so on. This here is a rather interesting circuit. This was an entry by Elcrefto to a challenge by Xizuma some time ago, where Xizuma challenged his viewers to make a 5x5x1 timer that would trigger some TNT. And this timer here was more or less in the victor, because this timer here needs about 50 real-time years until this observer here gets triggered. It uses some rather interesting circuits using a hopper clock with a combined observer clock here. At the back we have a counter using droppers, and here we have a dispenser which essentially needs to be completely emptied until this here gets triggered. So a very interesting circuit. I will put a link in the description for the corresponding video. Next we have a simple counter based on a hopper-dropper combination. So we have this hopper here which is currently locked, and a dropper with 5 stacks of items in there. And what I can do here is rather simply count the number of pulses I'm running into this dropper here, because I have put 5 pulses now in here and I have now 5 items in there. And if I unlock this, the whole thing automatically resets again. Very simple. And the last use is in combination with flying machines, because droppers and also dispensers and hoppers are immovable blocks, so they can block the movement or stop the movement of flying machines. But they can also restart those, because they can actually trigger observers. And with that we have finally reached the end of this episode about the hopper, the dropper and the dispenser. I hope I was able to explain to you how they work and how they behave and what they are commonly used for. I also hope you enjoyed this little episode, and well, see ya!